Comrade Srinivas, yes. I have come to meet you for the reason that I was one of those gathered near the Canara Bank on JC Road on 31st. As I have tried to explain that in the Facebook post, that all of us woke up to a shocking news unleashed on, particularly on the bank workers,
yes,
of the 10 banks,
yes,
and then the public also. But the public, unfortunately, they do not see the the problem that is inherent in this particular move of the government. The Indian public, in the last at least 5-6 years, we have been now accustomed to one shock after another.
Yeah.
Be it demonetization or GST, later the labor reforms and the Kashmir question, and whether one agrees with it or not, that's a different question. But it's a shock. Shock therapy has been going on in this country for quite some time now. But this latest shock of 10 banks being merged to make big banks, so that it becomes very profitable and people can buy and come and buy that, which you pointed out in your speech, is something that should be made known to the larger public, because there is no person, at least in the urban India, that who doesn't use a bank, and it affects our life.
Yeah. I will definitely echo your sentiments, and taking forward whatever I spoke on 31st, Comrade Jagdish, first let me start my reaction to this, this merger and acquisition. I was watching Mr. Vivek Debroy in his speech. I think it is ET now. Openly he was telling, after mergers it will be privatization. Why at all the government is doing this bank mergers if they are not interested in coming out of total control of these banks? Why nationalization took place in first place? What was the need in the year 1969 and subsequently 1980, 14 banks, subsequently 6 banks, all those things? Why they were? The common man, the downtrodden, the less privileged were not allowed to enter the bank. That was the scenario. This government or the previous government, they are under the impression that the taxpayers' money is being drained out. It is a dent on the exchequer of the government of India. But I want to ask one question to everyone. From 2002 to 2012, the country was recording a double-digit growth. 2002 to 2012. During that period, when the public sector banks were involved in lending to infrastructure, it was called private sector investment by public sector banks. Of course, the country has grown. The infrastructure, you can see, it is visible. And who are responsible? Public sector banks are responsible. We, the officers, are responsible for such a mammoth incremental improvement in infrastructure. Be it power, be it transport, roads and buildings, be it telecom, be it aviation. But what happened in the process? We were giving loans to all these sectors. We gave loans to Ultra Mega Power Project, UMPP, India. There are a few countries, maybe around 50-55 countries, who are signatory to Basel. Basel Committee is one, it is in Switzerland. Basel is a place where if you want to have international presence, if the banks want to have international presence, you should be signatory to that. And our Reserve Bank of India as a central bank, we are signatory to that Basel Committee. What does it say? If the loan repayment is not made within 3 months, that account becomes NPA, non-performing asset. Though you would have a huge collateral against that particular loan, as long as the money is not coming back, whether in mega power, ultra mega power project or telecom, so they could not generate income, they could not pay, automatically all those accounts became bad, and that has resulted in weak balance sheet of all public sector banks.
Nationalization, the nature of banking, how the ordinary common man was always a distant person to the banking industry.
Yes.
But the nationalization brought in people.
Yes.
Whatever little savings or whatever loans they were to get, they got it through this thing. And there was quite a number of pro-people measures through the this thing. And one thing that I know as a lay person, the public sector banks, even in their training,
yeah,
they used to import something called social banking.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah. So I would like how that concept of social banking,
yeah,
is going to be affected by this merger, which in your opinion is a prelude to privatization.
Yes. If the day on which the government reduces below 50%, that is exactly the prescription made by PJ Nair committee. Not only PJ Nair committee, so many committees who are all wedded to the privatization theory. So who are all thinking that privatization is the panacea. No. So as long as that doesn't happen, we are all safe. The day on which the government reduces its stake in public sector banks below 49%, then they will definitely will not have the say in the directed lending, that is priority sector lending. The priority sector lending is the most essential thing to take care of the common man in India. Whether it is a farmer, whether it is a salaried class, whether it is auto rickshaw puller, water rickshaw, or cycle rickshaw puller, or horse cart, or whatever it is. I doubt this type of social banking will be done by private sector banks once the government reduces its stake in the public sector banks.
Sir, comrade, there is one lingering fear amongst the people in the last, especially with the first round of associate banking, associate banks getting merged in State Bank of India, and also later Dena Bank, Vijaya Bank, and Bank of Baroda. While that was going on, a kind of an atmosphere has been created that this particular issue of merger of banks, which is a prelude to privatization, is a foregone conclusion. In fact, in your yesterday's speech, yeah, you also mentioned that. But apart from that, there is also, for example, take the example of State Bank of India itself. If you look at the branches, you know, I am a customer of the State Bank of India, Srinagar branch. If you look at the branch, the functioning of the branch, we can see that the staff are overloaded with work.
There are multiple...
There is no new recruitment. People who got retired have not been replaced with new recruitment. Maybe it is happening, very few. Visibly we can see that either the officer or the clerk in charge is under lot of stress. And even though they have said that, you know, some things are being taken care of with the automation, but we know how, to what extent in this country, even in urban areas like Bangalore, you need an attendant in an ATM or a deposit machine to do the function. Either the security person or a special attendant does that in most of the branches. In such a scenario, even the branches are getting closed, the ATMs are getting closed. In such a situation, ordinary people feel that this entire banking system is going to go. And I have also heard a rumor saying that Reliance and many other foreign institutions are already, they have a stake in institutions like State Bank of India. How far, as an insider, as a bank worker, what is your view on that? Is it true?
No, one thing, Reliance Industries, definitely they have a stake in State Bank of India. But they are having a very minority stake, there is no doubt in it. As long as the government has, that's what I have been repeating, as long as the government do not dilute its total controlling stake or majority stake, there is no problem. The day on which the government disowns and reduces below a certain level, which will pave way for the private entrepreneurs to get into, whether foreign institutional investors or foreign direct investment or domestic institutional, I mean private entrepreneurs in the domestic market, all those things are there. There is no doubt in it. But when you are talking about a couple of things, this automation and all these things, yeah, urban, this one, penetration into automation or digital banking, we call it as a digital banking, all those things. Yes, there are a couple of issues, there is no doubt. How far they are stable, how far they are reliable, how far they are prone to, keep away themselves from hacking is $1 million question. Another thing you pointed out, there is acute shortage of staff. I say not acute, is a chronic shortage of staff in most of the branches. There are umpteen number of reasons. One is the banks at the whole bank level, they are pushing towards alternate to traditional banking through digital banking and all. They are thinking that the automation or the digital will take care of the front line or transactional banking, so that the staff is not required. But the real problem is the customers are not 100% migrated to alternate channels because they are not comfortable. They are not comfortable. There are language problems. For that language problem, you have to address vernacular and voice-based apps. There are solutions for it. Okay, then there is another problem is called a digital identity. There are so many other things have to be brought in place so that you will depend upon wholly on digital banking. That is, we are caught in between the traditional banking and the digital banking. See, and there is no reliable connectivity. BSNL has an issue where we have leased line. Suppose I migrate to other leased lines, there are other issues. For example, Tata Teleservices, Tata Telecom has an issue. Suppose you go to Voda and Idea, they have merger, they have their own problems. So unless everything is in place, so you cannot force the common man to move towards digital banking till such time there is need of staff there. And rightly you have pointed out, there is no augmentation of staff at first place. Second, there is no replacement. Whoever retires, not filled. Whoever is promoted, not filled. Almost 10 years, there was no recruitment in most of the public sector bank. This is the area where government has to think to address unemployment issues. So this is really a serious problem.
Another thing, because even though public sector banks have played a phenomenal role in developing the economy and also even the vagaries of the policy makers, whether it is the UPA under Congress or the NDA under BJP. The policy makers, they seem to be of different colors, but there is a continuity in their madness.
Yeah.
So that is definitely, see, Chidambaram cannot play holier than thou now, or Arun Jaitley cannot be, of course he is dead, we can't speak ill of the dead, but they have all been behind the public sector banks, privatization. But then there is also a kind of a debate or a discussion, especially amongst the younger population, which is already favoring privatization. See, privatization is, as you said, they think is the panacea of all the evils and the ills in the society. So in that case, I think you passingly referred As to why the nationalization took place in this country. I mean, I have my own take, but please, as a banker, as a unionist, active unionist, I want your opinion.
Youngsters, they are not properly educated. They go by media hype. They go by, some forced thoughts or whatever it is. They would not have read completely. I don't find fault with them. They are not being disseminated with the right kind of information through your channel, through your media, whatever, whichever method you adopt, social media or print media or whatever. My humble appeal is to take it to the people, that is particularly youngsters. Because why I repeat youngsters, the demography says that their number is more now. They are, if you look at
around
the other
65%.
Countries, yes, one thing. Second thing, I have to go back to 1991 to talk about the present scenario. Whichever finance minister, that's what I say, even if left parties were to be today in the government, they also would have continued with the policies, because it started in the year 1991. And during this period, left parties were also partners in the form of United Front or whatever front you call. They were also party along with the Congress. They were also responsible. They are also responsible for this. Why I say I don't, that's what I said, we are apolitical. I am not interested in talking about any political party or against any political party. But it started in the year 1991 when Narasimham Committee financial sector reforms ushered in the year 1991 as a first. Then subsequently 1998, year I don't exactly remember the year, second set of reforms came in. During that period only, the foundation for privatization through disinvestment has been set in. It is continuation of policies. Whether Chidambaram, whether Arun Jaitley or somebody comes. So they have to carry out. Because these are all the conditions that were put by IMF and World Bank in the year 1991 when they extended grant to us, aid to us. So it is a continuation of that those policies. Third point. The very purpose of bank nationalization, was to take care of common man. The downtrodden, the women or the SAGs, the farmers, the rural artisans, the cobblers. You name any sector in the economy, they were not allowed except few industrialists. So now that was allowed and the kind of freedom was given to the public sector banks, of course, under the guided directed lendings of the RBI and of the government of India, whoever is running the country from 1969 till now. Okay, we are all public sector, they are owned by the government of India and we are bound to listen to them. We are employees of them and we have to listen to them. And till now, the common man is allowed with the head held high in the esteem. He will enter the bank. I don't think this would prevail once the privatization takes place. It is going to take place. It is a matter of years. I don't say it is a days. It is a matter of years. At that time, I don't know whether BJP will be there or XYZ government, NDA or UPA, some other form of the government will be there, but it will be too late.
Yeah. Then you mentioned, you put your finger on the pulse of the question that I wanted to ask. Nationalization per se, as you are a financial worker, I was a postal worker, he is an unemployed or a self-employed person. We all welcome nationalization from the point of view of common man.
Yes.
Because, all the vagaries of the economy, as individuals, we will not be able to cope up with. So we need assistance. We need assistance from the financial institutions. We can't go to private individuals. They will fleece us. So we will have to go to the banks. So in such a situation, India, with all its, it is a capitalist economy. At the end of the day, bottom of the this thing, it is the ground on which it is based. So when 1969, this is a different take that some of us have, some of radically who have departed from the general thinking of the left. So because in this country, Indira Gandhi's reforms of 1969, nationalization has been welcomed in a very, it's very good. It's a progressive step. But at the same time, we also have to understand nationalization under capitalist grip is a different thing, but nationalization with a genuinely democratic controls. We would have argued with workers' management, democratic workers' control over the nationalization of banks.
Exactly.
Then the situation that we are in now would not have been there. Whatever be the nationalization, it is the capitalist government that controls the public sector, industries or this thing. So you give it in left hand, you take it in right hand. That's what is happening. So what is your take on that, understanding?
I will definitely clarify everything. One thing I want to share was about just 10 minutes back, I spoke what happened in US in subprime crisis 2008. Capitalistic driven country pumping in trillions of dollars in the form of TARP to private sector banks. That has happened. So when that thing can happen, why pumping of money, maybe taxpayers' money according to us, but everyone is forgetting another contribution made by public sector banks. 2,20,000 crore is the dividend that we have given back to Government of India every year, put together, maybe in the form of dividend and maybe in the form of income tax or VAT or now GST or whatever service charges on that. It has been, the levy has been made and we are paying back to the government in the form of dividend. It is not totally acceptable theory that the public sector banks, they are drain on the exchequer and all. Totally, we don't agree with that. Okay, but for this 6-7 years chaotic situation due to weak balance sheet and all those things are there, yes. But I fully subscribe to your views. The whole country should be under the control of public sector banks in a democratic way.
We saw a lot of anguish in the faces, you know, as I entered the other day in the demonstration. I mean, the foreign-wide, you know, around 200-300 people had come foreign-wide from the city. And it happened in every major city, as I have gathered from the reports. So there is a lot of anxiety as to what's happening. Of course, as employees, their first and foremost concern is their own jobs. Madam Sitaraman has made an assurance that nobody will lose the job, but that's, we will have to take with a ton of salt, not even pinch, a ton of salt we have to take. Because that's not the way how the dynamics of capitalism works. But the other thing is that the I saw in the mood prevailing in that particular demonstration, especially with leaders like you really going for an agitational mode, there was feeling that we will stop, we will struggle, we will win. So one thing is rhetoric. One thing is to say that we have never lost a struggle, we will win it again. That's fine. I mean, that's how it should be. But what is the strategy? How the bank unions are really taking on this challenge to defeat? Because, you know, I mean, you said time and again, you have said that I'm apolitical. I don't think you're apolitical. You may not belong to your party, but we are all political at the end of the day because we are gowned and we suffer the politics of the country. That's my understanding. But the thing is, How are we going to defeat this? How? What is the strategy of the major nine unions? How many million members do you have?
12 lakh.
12 lakh, 1.2 million of members, you know. How are we going to do? I mean, I am part of the working class. But we want, you know, I mean, historically, if you look at the struggles of the working class in this country, bank workers have played a leading role. They are the first battalion to go out, whether it is a general strike or anything. But now it's a burning time. It's a burning issue. I mean, I feel it's not spelt out. In our leaflet, in our writing also, we have said, set a date.
Yeah.
As soon as possible, set a date. Yeah. And the bank workers unions have the clout to put pressure on the general trade unions to bring in other issues and go for a general strike. You know, only class action, in my opinion, only mass class action with a definite alternative can stop this.
Definitely, there is anguish and anger, no doubt. When this government wants to achieve 5 trillion economy, they have to take the bankers in their stride and meet our leadership and allay so many fears, not one or two, whether they want to go very seriously with the mergers. And I do not know merging the weak banks with the strong bank, in what way it is going to alter and in what way it is going to help the economy, I have my own doubt. Nobody is talking about ill effects.
Exactly.
That is what we want to talk. See, there are going to be HR issues. Okay. HR issues are totally not settled in many merged banks. I don't want to take the names. And merger of data is a Herculean task. Not all the software languages talk to each other so easily. Is another hard nut to crack. So many other issues are there. In the process, what is our fear is the customers will go away from public sector banks to private sector banks. That is the opportunity which is being closely watched by the private sector banks to grab the business. There will be definitely shift of business from public sector banks, which are getting merged, to private sector banks. In another way, you are helping the private sector banks.
So there are definite plans to for the struggle. But there's one criticism in general. Of course, I don't agree with that. I have already made my views very clear in the post that I wrote. That during the time of the demonetization, I mean, I have two of my relatives, my sisters work in Canara Bank, public sector bank, and I have seen many people, including my sister, who is a chronic arthritis patient, had to work until 12 o'clock, 1 o'clock in the night.
Yes.
And I have also heard stories or incidents that managers getting heart attacks because they could not cope up with this thing. As you know, more than 180 people died in those 10 weeks.
Yes.
And nearly 24 bank workers laid their life in the service. I mean, if it was a kind of a mini war, that 180 deaths, they should be, if we are giving such a national pride to the people who die in the border because of the surgical strike, here was a carpet bombing. People died. So we should be compensating them, including the bank workers who died in the process.
Yeah.
But the criticism that I want to come to is that why bank unions, which have such a massive clout in the financial sector, why they were mute spectators? I know many younger rank and file bank workers wanted some direction from the union leadership to say at least a work to rule. I mean, look, I am not going to work until 12 o'clock in the night. If that, even that was given, a call was given, there would have been a different atmosphere in the entire country. You know, by the way, people talk about Modi being a bad person, we have to build the struggle. I mean, I'm talking the language of the left, which I am. But the thing is, here was a Modi sent opportunity, but not God sent. Modi gave you an opportunity to really take him on. Demonetization was a blunder. As far as the people are concerned, it was a blunder. Now it is proved beyond doubt that nothing has been achieved of the demonetization. So, but from Kashmir to Kanyakumari, people were angry, people were frustrated. So in such a situation, even if you had lifted a little finger, there could have been a different situation. There could have been, see, Venezuela, within 3 days of the demonetization, under a dictatorship, it had to be rolled back. But here is a democracy, because of the lack of leadership to channel the anger, frustration of the people, nothing happened. So some people have gone too far in criticizing the ordinary bank workers. I put the blame on the leadership of the bank unions.
Exactly. It is a cadre-based trade union. Our bank union is a cadre-based. We follow whatever the directions given from our top leadership. When our top leadership, then when they did not give any call against to that, definitely no individual worker or state level leader can do anything. So this, ideally, this should have been taken up by the leadership at the top of UBU, entire UBU. Of course, that issue should have been tackled at that particular point in time. And again, I repeat, we follow whatever they say to us. So that's where something has gone. Crores of rupees coming to some alien country against the banks. So many theories.
I know.
So many theories were there also. And maybe probably because of that, our federation leadership also would have kept quiet or whatever it is. That's what I wish to
answer. Anyway, it's the times ahead, whether we want or not.
Yes.
It's a period of struggle.
Yes.
We will have to take on, I mean, bank workers unions and the leadership has an enormous responsibility on their shoulders.
Yes.
To lead the way, because the rest of the working class, I mean, because of their social position, they are not in a position to sustain a struggle. The bank workers have that sustenance within them. So we wish, the new Socialist Alternative wishes victory for the bank workers against this merger move, and also retain the public sector nature of the banks.
Thank you. Thank you, Jagdish. Thank you very much. Thank you.